It is day one of the shoot, and we're on our way to the set right now. We started quite early today at around 7-ish to do hair and makeup. I'm a little bit nervous because I haven't done a music video shoot for probably over a year already, so I'm nervous, but I'm also excited. But I guess like the nerves will get better once I get there.
When Red Records approached me, they kind of had like a existing mood board. Some of the visuals were like, you know, like a skater girl vibe. So I kind of just built upon that. And I think listening to the music, the whole vibe just felt like it's youthful, it's fun. And I really wanted to capture that essence. So I think the two locations that one could identify, that being the skate park, you know, having fun with your friends or going to the arcades. When you think about a skate park, you usually think like, you know, it's cement, sometimes clean, sometimes you got a bit of like graffiti. But I'm thinking with the location that we had, how could we bring colors? That was my idea. Like I didn't want to just have it look bland. So that's when the color panels came in. And because it's kind of like translucent, the idea was to sort of have the light hit it and to cast colored shadows onto the set. So as directors, you know, you just go wild with your ideas and make your producers work really hard.
Keep going, keep going! Woohoo!
So we're at our second location of the shoot, which is the skate park. And we just wrapped up the first scene here. We still got a couple more to go. I think it's gonna go pretty late today, but that's fine, I'm not tired yet.
When we went to the skate park in Putrajaya, there were other sections of the skate park itself that started giving me ideas. So when I saw that tunnel, I was like, this looks like a very interesting spot. Like, what if we put a LED screen and treat that like it was a studio? You already had the existing graffiti wall there. All we had to do is just add lights. We had a Sleep Talk who did really great visuals in the LED screen. So that really elevated the set.
Cut!
It's a wrap for day one, and I'm super happy about today. Everything went super smoothly, and everybody that I was working with was so nice. Everybody was so fun to work with.
My brain! I can't comprehend!
Day two starts in a couple hours, so I gotta go rest up.
Day two,
let's go!
So one of the interesting thing about this whole music video was Janine's bedroom. We actually built the whole bedroom set at the skate park itself. You know, we just kind of like controlled the lighting and whatnot to create a vibe. And then later, just before you went to the first chorus, we wanted to just create that almost one take wow effect where you realize that the whole time that bedroom was actually in the skate park itself.
Steven's debut. His first role.
Sorry, sorry, please make way for the real star on set.
And action.
I knew that the next location was an arcade. Usually you already have that sort of like neon lighting, so that helped a lot in terms of like, you've got a good base to start with. There was that scene where we see Janine with that sort of red glitter wall. It was literally, we went there, hey, this wall look interesting. Can we make something out of that? So we cleared the machines away. We just isolated that spot. So I think it's just a lot of trying to make the best out of the locations that we have, really just milking it, adding a lot of colors to it to just bring out that zest and energy of the song, I think. I kind of like wanted to also have a little bit of storyline to it. The way I interpreted the music video was Janine trying to get on his phone, figure out his passcode, but obviously failing many times before she finally cracks it. The set pieces, the bedroom, the skate park, and the arcade, I think those three elements represent the music and Janine as a person.
15 hours into the shoot, still going strong.
Janine really set the tone of the music video, not just what she brought in terms of her personality, but I think most importantly, that energy that she brought was just so contagious. There's that literal aura that she brings to set, the charisma. And that, I think, kept the crew always wanting to bring their best to the table. What we felt on set, we were so inspired. I hope, as a director, that I was able to translate that to the music video.
Okay, guys, it's a wrap for Boston!
Time to bring the bass back.
Mix is the beat of our culture. Our stories.
So I see myself having a couple number ones, number one albums.
Spotlighting inspiring content from Generation Mix. The next generation of creators, artists, and filmmakers. Our music. Discover fresh artists first from around the world. Uniquely Filipino.
It's hard to get this energy anywhere else.
Mix is the beat of our culture.
All right, hey guys, Danny Boy here, and I'm with a very lovely, talented singer who is promoting her new single, Passcode. Welcome everyone, Janine Weigel. How are you doing?
Hi, I'm good. Thank you for having me here.
Of course, thank you for your time as well. And where have you been stationed at, I guess, during this whole crazy pandemic?
Right now, I'm in Malaysia, in KL. I moved to Malaysia earlier this year, in February, before the lockdown happened. Okay. And it's also my first time that I moved out of the house. It's definitely been like a very interesting experience.
I can imagine. That's crazy. The timing of that is just very weird, I guess. But yeah. You seem to be doing well. You have a new song out called Passcode, and we're going to cover that in depth. But if you'll allow me to kind of backtrack and maybe get more info for the fans out there that are kind of wondering about your past and stuff like that. So for those that don't already know, you started doing YouTube covers like more than 7 years ago. And during that era, what made you decide to give that a shot, give that a try?
I think I'll just like refer back a little bit. I moved to Thailand when I was around 10 before I lived in Germany. Mm-hmm. And once I moved to Thailand, I got into the entertainment industry by acting first. And once I kind of like dabbled a little bit, I thought that like, oh, I want to try to compete in a singing competition. So once I did that, I realized that I wanted to pursue music as more than just a hobby. So once I finished that singing competition, I got signed to my first label. Mm-hmm. And once I was, I've been a trainee for around 6 months, I decided that like, oh, like I've seen all these amazing YouTubers that are so successful. I want to try that too, like see how it goes. And mm-hmm. I guess it's been working out well so far.
Definitely. I mean, I've seen so many and, you know, millions of views on a lot of those. But one of my favorites, not too old, your Old Town Road cover. I remember my niece or my, she's my cousin, but she's really young. My niece showed that to me when it was like first uploaded. So pretty cool that I'm talking to you now.
Wish I could roll on back to that old town boat. I'm gonna ride till I can't no more. I'm gonna take my horse to the old town boat. I'm gonna ride till I can't no more. I'm gonna take my horse to the old town boat. I'm gonna ride till I can't no more. Yeah.
So when you do covers, what helped you decide what songs to choose, and any cover that was like a challenge to you or that you were kind of like on the fence about before actually doing it?
I think for me, I try to cover the songs that are trending at the moment, but sometimes I also just cover songs that I want to sing in between those. Mm-hmm. But I think for the most challenging songs that I did at the time that I feel like was like really hard was like any Sia song, like okay. Chandelier, yeah. Titanium, or like even Jessie J's Flashlight as well.
Oh yeah. So after that, you know, when you started putting out originals, were you nervous at all about like the reception it'll get, because you were kind of known for doing covers and then going into original music? Did you have any like nervous excitement about it?
I think I was more like excited in a good way because before that I never really released any original music before, so there wasn't really like a bar or a standard that I thought that I should hit. There was like everything was kind of new, so it was just trying things out and seeing where it goes. But yeah, it was definitely a very memorable experience because the first original music that I put out was like 5 songs, an EP.
Right.
And I still remember the process of like going through from recording and then shooting the music videos. And it was a really, I guess it was a really fun time. Like it was very different from what I'm doing now, which it's like not in a bad way. It's just like, I can see how much I've grown from then until now.
Right, right. Was Deep End part of that first EP?
Deep End was from my second.
Second.
Like
awesome.
3 years ago, I think. Yeah.
So you speak multiple languages, right? You said you were born in Germany and you lived in Thailand. Now you're in Malaysia. Being mixed, I can relate to this, you know, blending of cultures and your unique perspective you gain from being, you know, from your ethnicities from both sides of the world.
Yeah.
Is it harder to create music in a certain language more than the other? Or, you know, what's that like for you?
I think for me, that's really hard to say because I've tried writing in both languages, both in Thai, German, and English, I guess. But I think for me, that I feel like is more challenging would probably be Thai because it's a tonal language, so you can't really play around with it a lot. But I like Thai songs where there's a lot of rhyming, and I feel like it's just a beautiful language in general. But in terms of like freedom in melody, I think English and German is much easier.
Okay, and fast forwarding a little bit, one of your song words, I love the lyrics, so
thank you.
I wanted to ask you, did any of those things you said in that song come true? You said a lot.
I have to like, oh my gosh, what did I even say? I think for me, it's kind of like, because I wrote that song during a time where I got a lot of backlash for like the way I sang or I represented myself. And it was also like, at some point I was in Thailand, I was trending like number one on Twitter for just like how the way my voice sounded, which I just wanted to kind of put out a message that those words can't bring me down. And like, because how I see it is that nobody can really stop you from pursuing your dreams unless you stop yourself.
Your words can touch me, but you'll never bring me down, 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 da, da, down.
You came to Manila not too long ago.
Mm-hmm.
Well, first part of that question is, what do you remember the most about the Philippines? And the second part is the culture. What culture similarities do we have, Filipinos and Thais?
What I remember the most, the first thing is the traffic.
Oh, God.
The traffic is crazy. I thought the traffic in Bangkok was crazy, but then I came to Manila and I was like, oh, Thailand is like normal. But I think one thing that I really like is the people there. Like, the people are really nice.
What's your passcode? How do you treat your mama? Does your ex give you drama? Things that I gotta know. How many pesos do you believe in karma? What color is your aura? Things that I gotta know. Did you lie?
Also, one thing that I was really surprised and amazed about was that everybody that I met were such great singers. Like, I don't know how you do it. Like, everybody can sing.
Yes, it's a very musical country. You know, every artist I talk to when we bring up the Philippines, they all say the same thing. Like, wow, Filipinos really sing well. You know, yeah, we support, like, even if it's not Filipino music, right? Of course, we support artists from around Asia and even the States. But when there's a song, no matter where you're from, if it's a good song, we're going to pick it up and we're going to support, just like like your new one, Passcode. So let's talk about Passcode now.
Sure.
Let's just break it down. Like, what is it about? And if you could also talk about, you know, the process of making it and like your mind state and everything that came about?
So Passcode is about falling in love with somebody but still being scared and having your guard up because you don't want to get hurt. And it's kind of like asking this guy for his passcode to his heart. At the end, you end up telling him how you feel about him anyway. And how it started with the process of making the song was actually earlier this year before the lockdown, I had the chance to go to LA and record a couple songs with Tommy Brown, who's Ariana Grande's producer, and his team. And we got a bunch of songs that I really liked, but we felt like, although there were great songs in that bunch, we felt like there isn't like that song that is fit to be the first single yet. So once I got back, Tommy sent me a couple more songs, and one of those songs was actually Passcode. And at the time when I heard the song, although it was still like a very simple demo, I felt like, okay, like this definitely has to be the first single, and my team agreed as well. So we started working on that and added a couple additional parts and like verses and all that. And also in terms of instrumentals as well. And yeah, just to like make it more me, I guess.
And it's really cool. You know, it's playing a lot here in Manila. And, you know, I wanted to talk about the music video itself. You were teasing the video. You had lots of teaser videos leading up to its eventual release. So can you talk about the concept of the Passcode music video?
For me, so there isn't like really a great, like a main storyline there. It's more like about like, I guess like trying to find out the guy's passcode, but.
I like it. I like it. It's funny. I like it.
Thank you. But in between there'll be shots like with me, like hanging out with friends and like, I guess like being at the arcade as well and at skate park. So in between of that storyline, I just wanted to like add, I guess like I would say like pretty views, pretty shots as well. Like for me, it was more important about the aesthetic of the music video
rather than
the storyline. But before like, I guess coming up with the concept was just like basically going on Pinterest and just creating a mood board, and I just sent that to the director, and we just kind of like worked around that. And
where was it shot?
In KL. I'm not sure. I think it's called Putrajaya.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
All right. There's even like a TikTok challenge.
Oh yeah, there is. There's a.
Yeah, let's talk about that.
Dance challenge.
But what is the hashtag again?
Hashtag Passcode challenge, I think.
Passcode challenge, and I'm not a dancer. I've only seen a few clips. So can you tell me, like, is there like a step or a certain step, or is it just you dance to that song?
So there are steps, and there are, I guess, two versions. There's a version where it's like simplified, and then the original version where like
that's for me. Yeah, the simplified one.
The simplified is like, I guess, like a lot easier, I guess, but
okay.
It's definitely been like very interesting to see all the people covering my song on TikTok.
Yeah. I've seen a few. Any of those that have really impressed you? Does anyone stick out?
One of them was by Darren Espanto.
Oh wow! Okay, yeah. Nice.
I was really surprised that he did that as well. I've met him last year at, I think, like a break room at a TV show or something, and we got introduced to each other, and like his voice is just amazing, like out of this world.
Yeah, he's definitely one of our best singers here in the Philippines. So that's cool. Darren got on that TikTok challenge for the hashtag Passcode.
I think
it's Passcode Dance Challenge, if I'm not mistaken.
I think so. I'm not sure. Okay.
I don't want to give the wrong information.
All I want is to be with you.
But everyone tuning in right now, I'm still here with Jenny Weigel. And you know what? I want to thank you so much. And I want everyone right now who's tuning in to support Passcode, stream it, watch it, share it, tell all your friends, vote for it for our countdown. And Janine, do you have any shout outs, or if you want to say or greet your Filipino fans right now?
I guess what I would want to say is I want to thank you all for the support on my song Passport, my new song. And yeah, hopefully I'll get to see you guys very soon once things get better and once we can travel again. But in the meantime, I hope everybody stays safe, and I hope you guys take care of yourselves as well. And yeah, I really can't wait to see you guys in person soon, hopefully.
Yes, thank you. And I gotta learn your dance steps, so the next time I talk to you, I'll try to see if I can do them. Last thing I wanna ask though is, what's next for you? Anything coming that we should be looking out for in the near future?
Definitely more music. I'm working on my next single right now, and if everything goes according to plan, I think I'm gonna release my song like in January, February, like beginning of next year. Okay. And I think for next year's probably gonna be a lot of singles first, but hopefully I get to work on an album soon, sometime in the future, I guess.
Very cool, very cool. Thank you so much, Janine. Hope you're doing well. Congrats on the new single, Passcode. And hope to talk to you again soon. So there you go. Thank you so much. God bless and take care.
God bless you.
All right. Thank you, guys.
What's your passcode? How do you treat your mama? Does your ex give you drama? Things that I gotta know. How many assholes do you believe in karma? What color is your aura? Things that I gotta know. Did you lie? You say no, you are lie. You could go. I need honesty, transparency, no sugar coats, no sugar coats. I won't be judgmental, maybe sentimental. All I want is to be with you. Cause I like you, boy, I really like you. But I've been through the fire too many times, so I gotta know, gotta know. Cause I really like you, pulling you inside too. But I've been through the fire too many times, so I gotta know, gotta know. Oops, did I say too much too soon? Oops, didn't wanna play it cool. Oops, I can't pretend, think we could be more than friends.
Friends. Yeah. Oops. What is good, y'all? DJ Marlino here, and I got a special guest in the house with me, my man DJ Kizza. He's a DJ, designer, producer out of Chula Vista, California. That's my backyard. And he is one of the co-founders of a charity Twitch raid called Sorry Not Sorry. And man, how are you doing?
I'm doing great. You know, it's just been busy the past couple of weeks because of this whole Twitch raid going on. Yeah. So, yeah.
So how did you guys... you know, because we heard from Nico not too long ago. He kind of told us his story. So tell me on your perspective, how did everything come together?
So initially, Nico actually hit me up first saying that, like, if I wanted to be part of the Sorry Not Sorry lineup.
Okay.
And that was like the very first week, round one. And it was just very small. We were just trying to work with whoever we had to work with at the moment. Yeah. And fortunately, I was one of them. And literally, that's when I just met Nico. I only known Nico for at least like 3 or 4 days prior to that. And then now, like, getting into that, we actually also had like 100+ hour raid going on too as well. So that's how, like, we all, or I ended up being like one of the founders as well, because I also helped shape like the lineup as well, and also the future lineups that we have within the coming weeks. And it's really cool because we just really brought all DJs all around the world all into like multiple lineups together. So yeah, that's how it came about.
And it's a little unfortunate of what's happening in the Philippines right now. I mean, the Philippines is notorious for typhoons, but it's actually been getting worse and worse as years keep going. So what was it about giving back to the Philippines this time around that was important to you guys?
I believe it's only right to give back, just because the Philippines has really shaped who we are as Filipinos, at least American, like all over the world outside of the Philippines. And like, plus the culture and heritage just traveled over land and seas just to give back to, like, it's only right to just give back to our country and then just show as much support as we can. As like, just being in a first world country is truly a blessing compared to the Philippines, like what we have and what they don't have, you know? So
And seeing the pictures coming back from the destruction that the typhoon has done, I mean, you know, I know it's heartbreaking, but, you know, tell me from your perspective, when you see those pictures, like, how does it make you feel?
Man, it's just, it's really shocking to see, like, how much damage it's done to the Philippines. Like, I can't imagine it happening to America, just because we hardly get anything like that out here.
Yeah, yeah. Especially in, I mean, San Diego alone, we get 75 degree weather and we complain how cold it is sometimes, you know?
Yeah, so. we complain how hot it is. We complain like the gas prices, you know, unlike the Philippines, they got to deal with more stuff. Yeah, first world problems.
So you guys have done this for the past 2 weeks. It's been on a Sunday every, you know, for the past 2 weeks. And so far you guys have raised $7,000, which is equivalent to 335,000 pesos. Did you expect to get the type of response you're getting now?
To be completely honest, I didn't expect it. Like, I only expected just to hit the benchmark goal. I didn't expect we'd go above and beyond and just overachieve the goal, like just $1,000+ here. Because I remember the week one, our goal was only 2,000. It was just, you know, just like the bare minimum. That's all we expected. But we didn't expect to go 3,000 at the very end of the day.
Yeah.
And then with prior to our previous round two Sorry Not Sorry lineup, I didn't think we'd hit our goal so early. Like, I think we're like, what, 6 or 7, maybe 5 DJs in, I lost count, but we didn't hit the goal till like when I was up, which was, I was the second to last.
Yeah, yeah.
So yeah.
That's amazing. Now, have you been to the Philippines before?
Yeah, I have, but it's been so long. Last time I went there was when I was 3 years old and I'm 21, so it's been almost 2 decades.
Oh wow.
But I do have family, a lot of family out there, so.
Okay. Okay. And are you still in contact with them? Do they know what you're doing? And
In terms of my contact with them, my mom's mostly in contact with like all of her family out there. They're like all over the place, like San Felipe, Zambales, Zamboanga and whatnot. I'm not in close touch with them as close as I am with my mom and grandma, but my family knows what I'm doing out there for them out there. So yeah.
That's pretty cool. And so you've, like you mentioned before, you guys have connected with so many DJs around the world, especially Filipino DJs from all around the world. What have you enjoyed most about connecting with them?
Man, the thing I love the most about working with everyone on the lineup is just seeing how different each DJ is around the globe, you know, just like their sound, their creative output.
Yeah.
What else? Yeah, it's just like all the different styles we could get, like from ranging from like the UK or Canada or in America, you know, and like also like different backgrounds, like let's say like the Bay Area DJs and whatnot, East Coast DJs and et cetera. So yeah.
And you guys had a pretty big lineup this past weekend. You have a bigger lineup coming up this coming weekend. Who were some of your favorites from last week?
Cheesy, he's like only like 5 to 6 months younger than me. Bite Size for sure. Nico Blitz for sure, yeah. And I think prior the week before that as well, I have to give an honorable mention to DJ Miomor. So amazing. Yeah.
So we got DJ Kizza in the house. He's talking about the Sorry Not Sorry Twitch Raid charity fundraiser for the typhoon in the Philippines. So last question for you, any special message you want to give to, you know, your confounding team, as well as all the participating DJs and donors that have been a part of this whole entire movement that you guys have started?
Yeah, so I just want to give a huge thank you to Nico Blitz for putting me on. He's probably the most impactful person that I've ever came across on Twitch. And also big shout out to Cassandria and I'm That Guy Rye for also letting me be able to work with them as well. And a big shout out to all the DJs on the lineup for helping us raise money, and also to the viewers as well, because we literally couldn't have not raised any of the money without the viewers and the DJs. So big thank you to them as well.
Amazing. So DJ Kizza is in the house. And if you want more information about the Sorry Not Sorry Twitch Raid charity stream, we have an amazing lineup coming your way, coming this weekend and the next following Sundays. Just go to mix.global to get all the information.
Disney UK's 2020 Christmas ad is warming hearts all over the world. And the results are in for the Miss USA and Miss Teen USA pageant. It's your boy Nino here with this week's title hot list. We have those stories, plus some new music recs coming your way. Some say it's too early to usher in the Christmas spirit, but Disney UK thinks otherwise and has already lit up the first bottles. This year's Disney UK advert tells a generational story of traditions that begins in 1940s Philippines, when a young girl receives a Mickey Mouse doll in a scene set outside on a cobblestone street resembling Vigan in a local sur. The Christmas ad takes form in a 3-minute animated short that was released earlier this week and has amassed over 15 million views and counting on Facebook alone. Being shared by surprised and excited Filipinos from all over the world. The response and viralness of this ad just goes to show you that representation does matter, and our stories are worth being told. Here's a couple of med students from our community who are hitting it big in the pageant world. The Miss USA and Miss Teen USA pageants took place this past weekend, and Ke'ilani Aruda of Hawaii is taking home the crown for Miss Teen USA.
Hawaii!
The 18-year-old college student from Kapwa, Hawaii is a big advocate of autism awareness. She's a pre-med student at the University of Puget Sound in Washington. She's not the only one from our community taking home a prize. Over in the Miss USA division, U.S. and Philippine dual citizen Kim Lane of Nampa, Idaho is runner-up to Miss USA. The 25-year-old is a student at Washington State University, where she is pursuing a Doctor of Veterinary Medicine degree and a Master's of Public Health. Baby AJ from California and Baby Boston from Winnipeg are both in need of stem cell donors. AJ is battling a rare form of leukemia, and Boston is battling a rare immune disease called HLH. Because matching stem cells are likely to be found among people of the same ethnic group, both patients are facing low Filipino donor numbers in their respective countries.
It's been tough.
It's been, you know, really hard 30 days.
For AJ, you can visit aadp.org/homekit, and for Boston, you can visit the Canadian Blood Services website to see if you could be a potential match. Sending love and prayers to baby AJ and baby Boston. We hope you both find your match soon. Up next, check out what Mix has been up to. ABS-CBN Global has officially announced the rebrand launch of Filipino-American media platform Mix. Mix is the first global platform that celebrates the next generation of Filipino artists, creatives, and filmmakers. Currently distributed in over 20 million homes via cable and satellite in the US, Middle East, and Guam, Mix is expanding digitally to Amazon Prime Video, Twitch, and Kumu. This rebrand also brings new programming to Mix, including our very own Tayo News, alongside shows like Filgrimage, My Motto, The Crossover, Mixtape, and the number one show for Filipino hip-hop and R&B, Heavy Rotation.
It's hard to get this energy anywhere else.
Keep up to date with Mix by following them on their socials at Mix Global, and check out their newly launched site at mix.com. Global. Need something new to add to your playlist? We got you. These artists just dropped some tracks worth listening to.
It's a little perplexing when the heart is dyslexic.
LA-born Ken San Jose is killing it in the Philippines and just dropped his first Tagler song, Halma. Along with a music video showcasing this World of Dance alum's signature dance skills.
Consider yourself blessed. You got to.
Last but not least, we got Icy Queen Saweetie tapping in Janae Aiko for her latest track, Back to the Streets. An animated lyric video for this song was also released and already has over 4 million views on YouTube. That's the latest from the Tayo Hot List. Make sure to keep up to date with us by following us on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. And don't forget, you can now catch us on Mix Global. It's your boy Nino, and I'll see you all next time.
That was the Tayo Hot List. Thank you guys for watching that. And coming up in just about 30 minutes, Leisha from the Philippines will be on Heavy Rotation here on Mix to talk about her brand new song, Sad Song. And you get a chance to watch her music video. In addition to that, my man Mark Atienza is going to be in the house for a special remix. So make sure you tune in. Take a break. Come back in 30 minutes. And we'll see you guys soon for Heavy Rotation here on Mix.